jail or out of jail or whatever. There's reasons we can't do that. But even if we were to do that, that doesn't deal with the 70 non-compliance issues that we have. So those are the two issues we're dealing with. Okay, this is not a cost analysis situation because building the jail is not going to save us money, obviously. It costs us money. Unfortunately, people committing crime costs us money. I wish it didn't, but it does. But number one, significant undercrowding. Number two, 7 major non-compliance issues. I will tell you that in the past 2 years, we have not been alone in our efforts to try to find solutions. We've reached out to a number of folks to try to help us find a wide variety of issues, or solutions, I should say. Some of the folks we talked to at length, the Georgia Sheriff's Association, we've talked to all the local judges, Superior Court judges, State Court judges, Magistrate Judge, Clerk of Court, trying to find other solutions to building a new jail, including if we add a court, if we add judges, if we add additional public defenders, you know, what will that do to the inmate population? So we've actively sought other solutions. We talked to the governor's office of planning and budget at length, and they've helped us quite a bit with the data that you're going to see tonight. We talked to a number of jail consultants, architects, folks that actually build jails. And the last jail was built in the mid-1990s. The folks that built the jail never built a jail. It was built on the cheap by people that never built a jail. That's part of the problem. So we're trying to go from worst in class to best in class and try to learn from past mistakes and get people that actually know what they're doing and how to build a jail. We've got quite a bit of information from the Georgia Department of Community Affairs Office. So I just wanted to give you that laundry list of folks because this is not something that we've done locally in our county office or in the sheriff's office. We've really reached out to a lot of people to try to be as judicious as possible and as efficient and as effective as possible with your money. It's your money we're talking about, and we know that. In my money, that I pay taxes on. So we don't want to spend your money frivolously. So with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to the sheriff. And again, I want to thank you for being here.
Spring broke, we caught up with them. We went way up and we've leveled back out to visit a high of 239 at one point in time. Back to, we're about 170 today. We have 45 out of that. So we're trending on line with all the other jails in the state. Some are overcrowded, some are full, raw. Most of the jails, if you look at the statewide number, we had today, it's about 86% full statewide in county jails. So the population, we talked about a 300-bed jail. How did we come up with that number? Did we just pull it out of the sky and come up with a 300-bed number? Well, like I said, ours is 130. We run between 180, we run 170 today, but in 240. And that number fluctuates. So on the weekend, there'll be more in jail. During the week, the number goes down. On the weekend, it spikes up. It does that number. So just because we have 170 today, don't mean we won't have, you know, close to 200 this weekend. Yes, ma'am.
Is there a place that you can go to see kind of a breakdown of the different people that are in jail? Like, I know y'all provided information of the amount of people that are awaiting trial, but then is there some other breaks that are into, like, first-time offenders, non-violent offenders, repeat offenders?
That data is in our system, but we don't have the ability to get it out. So, no, ma'am. And I'll kind of expound on who's in jail and stuff and some of that here in short. So, population, this number, this stuff comes from the Governor's Office of Planning and Budget. The population of jails expected to increase 24% over 20 years. So in 30 years, the inmate population is expected to be well over 300. So you take your population of your county and you do some math with a formula and you come up with the size of the jail. So in 30 years, and that's what we're talking about, we're going to build a jail, we're going to have a bond referendum, we're going to pay out for 30 years, and it ought to last us for 30 years, right? We should be in this spot 23 more years, in 20 years. We should be doing this again. So we done the math, and you follow that 300 bed range. So we are housing that inmates. This cost is anywhere from $45 to $60 a day. It just depends on where they're at. We have 45 housed out. We're trying to house out 10 more. But we can't get nobody to take them. No one else around us has room. Now we can go to the south, and we can go, I can go to South Georgia, I can get all the bed space I want, but I'm gonna go to South Georgia. But that's, now we're bordering on ridiculous, you know, trying to house that inmates going that far. So Georgia Sheriff Association is one of the resources we looked at, it's a 350-400-bed jail. Some of the existing concerns, of course, the population exceeds the capacity. There's not designed for expansion, so when you look at the jail, there's one little picture of it. It's all outside walls. It's called a linear style jail. It's kind of like a sheet cake. It's long and it's narrow. All the cells are on the outside edge. And the jail we're looking at building is called a pod system. It's kind of like a cake. You slice it, or a pie, and you slice it in the rectangle. So some of the issues, of course, it doesn't comply with jail design standards, which one of the big ones that we was talking about, one of the things we don't do, we're not ADA compliant. ADA compliant, which means people with disabilities come to jail too. They're in wheelchairs, they're on crutches. We are not ADA compliant. You can't even get a wheelchair in the block. You know, so you can't get a wheelchair in the showers. That's a big one. It's one of the big ones. Of course, you have your security and safety, your officers and the inmates. Our biggest block holds 86. So when you get 86 people out at one time, of course we don't let that many out, we kind of break it down in quarters to let them out. But when you have the baby daddy's brother-in-law in there, and he's mad because he beat up his sister, it's a true story now, you have to watch who you let out together because he causes fights. There's also racial tensions. We get that same thing in the jail. Our biggest fight we just had not long ago, it's all about race. That's what it's all about. And they got a fisticuff about it. So one of the concerns is the ongoing transportation of housing out of inmates. So when's the last time I drove to Lumpkin County over to Dahlonega? Drove to downtown Dahlonega. At night, in a van, with 9 people chained in the back of it. They do it every day. Every single day they're running back and forth to Dahlonega, to Hall County. That's on the Black County, we have some in Stevens County, we saw some, we might be one or two of those spots. Our biggest area is, we have 25 at Hall County, and we have about 15 at Pumpkin, something like that, and we have some females sitting in White County. And we also only let the female carry the female inmates. Yes, sir. Yes, absolutely.
Okay. The jails that y'all are using to transfer to, do you have any idea if those counties are property or they just found a big dog where they can break in?
Oh, no, this ain't about giving a break. This is September, it's almost October. September, August. We paid Lumpkin County $64,500. One month. That's just Lumpkin County. That wasn't any of the others. So yes, they are profiting off of it. Because what it cost us,
if they're profiting, how about some negotiation?
I said, take your inmates someplace else. That's exactly what they say. Hawkeye says, yes, I'll house them. It costs you $60 a day. If you don't like it, go someplace else. That's exactly what they tell us.
I said,
sir, absolutely. It ain't got nothing to do with the commissioners. It's all up to the sheriff. The sheriff runs the jail, not the commissioner. This building ain't got nothing to do with the commissioners. Running the jail has nothing to do with the commissioners. That's what got us in trouble in the first jail. Commissioners built the jail. I'm not trying to be ugly. I don't want to put the blame on you. This ain't about putting the blame on anybody either. It is what it is. Bill, it is what it is. I don't want to blame nobody. It ain't the commissioner's fault. It ain't the architect's fault. It ain't the sheriff's fault. It is what it is. But all of running the jail comes down to the sheriff. And it's up to him what he wants to do with her or her. Now, if Janice Mangum, she only charges us $35 a day to house inmates. But I can't get her to take any more inmates because she's full. Now, she's got 280 beds. And if she would open up that wing, I'd take every one of my inmates down there. But she only charges $35 a day. But the rest of them, they charge what they want to charge. Now, it cost us about $50 a day. That's what it cost us to run the jail per inmate. Now, that number fluctuates. It depends on how many is in jail. It depends on a whole bunch of stuff, but that's just kind of a roundabout number. So some of these other jails, especially if you look at Hall County, they make a whole lot more money. So the sheriff said their cost, what it costs them to run that jail, is $60 a day per inmate. That's why they charge us $60. Lumpkin County says it charges the cost them $55. That's why they charge us $55. So herein lies that's why they charge that money.
We also use Jackson County?
No, Jackson County's full. Janice Mangum is full. They have a 400-bed jail. And they have 200 inmates, and she will not go to the 200 inmates because she's fighting with the commissioners and she won't give them money. It's a big deal. But anyways, they run 17 officers per shift in the jail. We run 5. And they won't open up the pot. So if she had opened up, we'd send them down. It'd save us money, it'd be easier, but Mike's County's full. Mike's County's full. Their jail's only 70 beds, 68 or 70, something like that. It's Banks County, they're full. Rayburn County is a 92-bed jail. It's full. They're fixing to build on and add 64 beds, expand over 128 that they just done SPLOST on to expand their jail. Stevens County is a 220-bed jail. It's full. White County's full. Males, they can't take any more males, they have room for females. That's why we send females to White County. Some of the non-compliance standard issues, inadequate cell space, lack of handicap accessible. That's a big one. That's a big one. What happens in your business if you're not ADA compliant? You get in trouble, right? So we can too. Narrow security corridors. So when you're escorting an inmate, you want an officer on each side of them for control. One, so the inmate don't hurt themselves, or if they're just not able to walk. You know, you have to sideways or whatever. Multiple occupant sales. It's one of the things we raised the bed count in the jail from 130 to 160. And so we went into six-man cells, and we made them eight-man cells. So that compounded the problem. Take you and seven of your closest friends and live in a confined box and see what happens. It don't always work out because you're having to build a bathroom in front of them, you're having to sleep with them, you're having to eat with them, all that stuff in there. And that this doesn't work. Women are not that big of a problem. That was get along. Poor visibility monitoring inmates. We have one spot where you're looking in one of the blocks, there's a 12-foot setback to a shower that you can't see. And then in the big block, in that hose 86, the bottom shower and the top shower, we're going to use the top shower right now. The bottom shower, there's about a 4-foot setback that you can't see. And then, male, female sign and sight separation. So remember taking a can and string and talking to your friend, your buddy. They do it with the toilet because it's a stacked unit and the toilet's in the front and the chase. So they talk through the toilet and listen. And I didn't believe it until we tried it. But it's just like they're talking to one another through the toilet. And then they like to pass notes. So they go by the door and they bang the door. That's the code. Notes fixed to pass. So if there's an officer in the block, somebody goes over and they start distracting the officer and they go over and pass the notes underneath that door. We can't close the door because it's a fire door. So we can't close that door. Floor space is limited in the jail. Inadequate holding, lack of security barriers, intake, and movement. So when you're dealing with someone, and this always happens on the weekends because they're in on road or wherever the problem is, you're sitting there with them and there's nothing to separate you except a little big small wall between them and the one you're dealing with. So I talked about on the weekends how the jail population goes up. It's not unheard of for us to have 20 people come to jail on the weekends. So there'll be one female, 19 males. We have two holding cells. So it gets real crowded real quick. And it takes us about 45 minutes to book in one person. That's going through all the medical questions, all the background questions, all the other stuff that we have to go through. And then if they go in the back, we have to dress them out and put them in the back. We have to shower them. So it's about 45 minutes to get one person booked in. Oh, where are we at? So we talked about adding the other beds in the jail. We already crunch in our kitchen space, so when you add, 30 more miles to try and feed inside the jail, then it really does become cramped. When they fix lunch in the kitchen, they fix about 20 trays at a time, and they take it out the hallway, and they stack it in an insulated carrier, and go back in the kitchen, fix about another 20 insulated trays, and they bring them back out, stack them in the carrier, until they get all the meals ready, and then they roll them out and give all the meals out. You can only have about four people, maybe five at the most, working in the kitchen because you're stumbling all over each other. Our kitchen's not air conditioned. And we just redid the heat and air 2 years ago on the building, We finally put a swamp cooler on there. We know what a swamp cooler is. So now instead of being 120 degrees, it's about 100 degrees in the kitchen. And real muddy. So, our inadequate medical room, we have one room. One room that serves as the exam room, it serves as the medical dispensary for their medications. When the dentist comes, they put the dentist chair in the middle of the room. So we have one room, and we have an office. Because we took out the library / attorney meeting room, where the attorneys would sit down and meet with their clients. We took that room out because we were storing medical records in the bathroom. So at night when they did the sugar checks for those who were on insulin, they go in the bathroom. And guess what's sitting in there? Medical records. HIPAA. So Well, they take all that out and have the nursing in their own office where we keep the medical records separated from everybody so we wouldn't be violating HIPAA rules. So what do we do? We look. We can keep going the way we're going. Take no action. And again, it's not about housing our inmates. It's about all the issues with the facility. So I didn't, I guess it's a good time to kind of talk about who's in the jail. Who's in the jail? Not drunks. Yeah, who's in the jail? Yeah, who's in it?
Violent, nonviolent.
There you go, violent, nonviolent, DUI. So everybody's in the jail there, just about. I didn't know, let me look today, so many misdemeanor cases we had in jail. 8% of our jail population is misdemeanor charges. Everything else is felonies. Yeah, 14 or 15 bodies inside the jail are misdemeanors. That's kind of a guess. So we have drugs, whether it's possession, most of it is selling, or child molestation, murder, rape, aggravated assault, burglary, thefts of all kind, deposit account fraud, armed robbery. There's two or three others on there. Those are people in jail. Then we have a lot of folks who are on probation. And 99% of them are felony probation, which means they were charged with drugs, child molestation, blah, 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 whatever. And then they couldn't hear probation. They didn't report, they got them on the charge, they had a dirty P test, whatever the issue was, now they end up in jail. So folks are there on probation. We'll set for a month, 2 months, 6 months. Sometimes that's before they even go see the judge. Then they might just do a revocation and take 3 months. Well, if they've been in jail long enough, they always get 2 for 1. That's state law. We have to do that. Then they don't have to serve another month. And maybe they get that time served. So most of the folks we have in jail are all felony cases. Now you have some misdemeanors that'll have, you know, they'll have, so they'll have DUI, fleeing, reckless driving, you know, a whole bunch of felonies like that. We have a few there that's on misdemeanor probation because they can't do probation, they won't do probation. So I know we have two that are serving 200 plus days on misdemeanor charges because they won't do probation. They won't do it. They won't report. They won't do what they're supposed to do. The judge finally broke down and put them in jail to serve time. Those are the people who are in jail. These are not misdemeanor weed cases. These are not public drunk cases. These are not disorderly conduct. These are not the people who's in jail. The people who are in jail usually need to be in jail. Then I get the call from mom. Hey, my son doesn't need to get out because I'm going to find him dead because he overdosed. He doesn't need a bond. Can you keep him? You do the best you can. Because by law, they get him. And then so we try and help with drug treatment. Mental health is huge. We talk about mental health. We have mental health that comes in the jail and does evaluations for people. So we can try and get them some help push them towards rehab. You know, we call the public defender, we call the DA's office, we do all the legwork lots of times to try not to get these people into rehab so they're not coming back. Because drugs and mental health is what's filling our jail up. If y'all can solve those two problems, we won't need a new jail.
I know that y'all, as the Sheriff's Department, your primary goal is to deal with the housing. Is that like a different, is there somebody that's kind of over
probation,
that?
Probation. somebody needs drug, if somebody needs drug rehab, there is no state, I'm talking to my state representative back there. There is no state that's, I'm just kidding. Chris does a great job. There is no state drug rehab for people. There is none. There is none, period. So you have to go through either a faith-based or one of the other organizations out there to do drug rehab. Drug rehab is our number one. Meth is still king in Habersham County. Meth is king. Heroin's coming up. Prescription pills. Then we talk about the opioid epidemic. It ain't always just opioids. There's a methamphetamine epidemic. There's a heroin epidemic. There's a cocaine epidemic. There's a marijuana epidemic. If you don't think that high school kids, they don't believe that marijuana is bad. I got a 19-year-old who just got out for selling heroin, who started doing weed when he was 13 years old. So don't tell me it's not a gateway drug. I can give you names and names and names of people who started doing weed when they were kids. And now they're doing heroin, and they're doing meth. And I can give you the names of some who died on overdoses, and they started doing weed. So there's all kinds of epidemics. I think you had a question.
Are we holding many people for state? Do we keep some of them?
The only ones we really hold for state is when we talk about going for state, they go before the judge and they're sentenced. Okay? So they say, Stacy Hall is going to prison for a year. Sorry, Stacy. So Stacy will sit in our facility maybe a week before he goes. Right? Now Michael Gauss, I'm going to pick on Moose. Michael Gauss is going to go to boot camp. Or you're going to go to RSAT. That's the big one. You're going to go to RSAT. RSAT is the drug treatment program inside the prison system, which is tremendous. Works great, by the way. Works great. Needs to be bigger. Need more. He'll sit and wait maybe 6 months on our dime, no reimbursement, doesn't count towards good time, to get his bed in RSAT. Females are the same way. Now, if we have him going to the BDC or boot camp, they'll wait 30 to 60 days to go to boot camp. Byersville, Hall County CI, those are boot camps. So they can't do probation, so they'll send them to boot camp. They'll go out and pick up trash and do those things like that. So that's the only time we hold them. If they're going to prison, it's quick. And if they're a problem child, I can have them out that day or the next day.
Well, you know, I've heard before where some jails, they have, you know, took the state a long time to come get prisoners.
They used to. It used to take them forever to come get inmates.
They're doing better than that.
They set 6-8 months before they go into prison. Well, now we have judicial reform. The state's saving billions of dollars. And now we're getting all these probationers. Okay, where are we at here? I know I'm chasing that. Renovated, expanded existing jail. So some of the issues with the existing jail. There's a 4-inch sewer main that serves our building. Anybody see the issue with that? 130 people, 140 people. And inmates like to flush the toilet. Studies show 8 times an hour. And we have 3-gallon toilets. So when they want to stop up the jail, or they want to flood the jail, actually they don't want to flood the jail, they actually want to flood the admin hall, because that's where it goes. So in the big block, they flush blank wool blankets, you know the military wool blankets, we have some of those, and sheets. They keep mashing that button, they just feed that sheet there, and they feed plastic and books. We don't let them have books much now. Why don't we give them books? Because they carry them suckers up and flush them down the toilet. They stop up the line. You know where the clean out plug is for that section of pipe? Because if we're standing in jail looking back towards the front of the building, it runs forwards towards the admin hall, is where that runs before it goes out. Who designed that? But it runs up there. Guess where the clean out plug is for that line? In our break room. Right front sink. That's where rotor rooters got to come in and clean out the line. And they know that. So to fix that, you got to demolition everything just to fix that. So we looked at that and took out our padded cell, but we couldn't make it back into the drain line because you have to have a drain on the floor, so we didn't do it. A couple weeks ago, we had mattresses taped up on the walls in a cell because a young man was running to it like he was a goat. Headbutting the walls, trying to bust his head up. So we had mattresses taped up on the walls. He is truly a mental health case. It's, I think, a drug abuse, but he's a mental health case. Because those two go hand in hand now. Mental health and drug abuse, the line's so blurred you can't even hardly tell, especially on the heavy use drug abuse. It's hand in hand. And we rust, mold, mildew. When the jail was built, it was a 70s-style jail that was built with exhaust fans and open windows. You can open the windows up. And had air conditioning. So what happens when you leave all the windows open with air conditioner and heat running? Power bill sky high. 2 years ago, they closed those windows up, screwed them shut from the outside, turned the fans off. Well, guess what happened to the power bill? Cut it in half. So now you got all these bodies trapped in the building that wasn't designed for heat and air. So there's not good return on the air. So now you got that moisture in the air. In the C block, which is the one I showed there, the maximum cells, during the winter time when they're in there breathing in that room, shut up, because the toilets are open too, so you got a lot of moisture. The breath condensates on the outside wall and it runs down the wall, and we have to give them extra towels to put on the end of the bunk so it won't soak their covers and their sheets and stuff. And they have to sleep with their head at the other end of the social pillows. That's how much moisture we deal with in that jail. And we just took that block and sanded it down and prettied it up just a couple years ago. We can't stop the dust. It's there. And then we can't stop it. 4-inch sewer main. So we're going to run 2 sets of showers at one time. You know what happens? Trying to run 3, backs up through the drains, every one of them. Backs up through the drains. So, talk about we had some showers on the second level. So when you use those showers, all the water comes down, flows across the floor, across the mezzanine, and into the floor on the bottom. The bottom showers, we've redone some of the plumbing, tried to, and helped with the problem, but they still have to go out there with squeegees, and we keep black mats out there to keep the water squeegeed up, pushed over to the drain, the other drain in front of the shower. Because there's so much water that comes out of the thing. You can't control the water pressure. We either have the showers on or have the showers off. So, viability and things like that. That's where we landed at this thing. 314 bed. Expandable to 504. So in 50 years, if they need, whoever they are, you know, the people running the county at the time, need 200 more beds, guess what? We've already provided the support for 500 beds. All they have to do is go in and build a shell and put the cells in. And these are going to be steel cells from Steel Cell North America involved. Local company. That's who we want to build this shell. That's who helped. Mike Smith and his crew helped get us where we are. We started this. Me and Les started this with a piece of paper sitting at a desk. We started drawing and writing and figuring and talking to Mike and talking to his consultants. So when the county, when Mr. Sutton got involved, and got the commissioners involved, got precision planning involved, and they drew up these plans we're going to look at. That's the only money we've got tied up to this. So we had to spend a lot of money. But Mr. Sutton, after we laughed at him and said, oh, there's no way we'll need a 300-bed jail in 30 years. But he didn't match it. He said, oh, I guess you're right. So we went back, we bantered back and forth about this, you know, where we need to be. And we come in at a higher number than that, and we went back and did some refiguring and took some stuff out and dropped near $2 million off the price. And yeah, we can get this price on down. We could get her down and spend $20 million. But what we're gonna have. So the jail itself is going to be about 91,000 and change square feet in size. You see the different areas and breakdowns. There'll be 32 beds inside the facility that we can add immediately without having to build a wall. The jail's going to be located right next to the old jail, 115, parcel down here. These are the plans we come up with. And this is not reinvent the wheel plan. This is what about every other county, except when you get to the big counties, are building. See the big counties when they're building towers, like DeKalb County, Gwinnett County, Harding County, they're fixing to build a $500 million jail or something silly. And it's a multi-story, but it's still built on the same principle right here in pots. That's what we're talking about, pots, pieces of a pie. Each one of these beds, each one of these little areas is 32 beds. That area right there is the indoor rec yard. So there's no door outside anymore. It's all inside. This back part is two-story. So the second story part of the big garage door. You open the garage door, that satisfies the requirement for being able to see the sky. That's what we have to have. This area right here is empty. That's the mean we can add 32 beds on a purple wall inside the facility. As it says right now, so we're in 14 beds, just like this. With the big medical area, it's got 8 cells plus 2 padded cells. This is all the intake area. There's the other second padded cell. We have 2 holding cells for juveniles. Because yes, we deal with juveniles. And yes, we can hold them for a little while. Because they're doing the armed robberies, they're doing the car thefts, they're doing the carjackings, they're doing the shootings. Deputy Dixon, shooter 17 years old. The only admin in this building is going to be right here. That's the admin area. The rest of this is jail.
All right, I'm assuming White County, Rayburn, Stevens, they're all having the same problem that we are. The jails are full.
Yes.
What's the feasibility of doing one like twice this size and putting it on the county line with one of them and split the cost? Just saying, because you could double the size of the cells, add the number of cells, and the admin and everything else, it's going to be a lot cheaper than $31 million, like to double. It ain't gonna cost another $31 million just to double the amount of sales that you got in it. And if we could split it with another county, you know.
Yeah, that was looked at. They was looking at Tri-County Jail. Back is actually actively built. The jail is in. It was looking at it with Steve before Stevens County built their jail and before Rayburn County built their new one. It's talking about a Tri-County Jail somewhere out there at Palm Airdale area. The issues that come up at the time is. Each county and each of this got to talk about it. Each sheriff has got to say, okay, we're going to hire Michael Dawson to run it. You know, us three get together and we're going to hire Michael Dawson to run it. And we got to step back and guess what? We got hands off of it and let Michael Dawson run it. And then each county shares in the liability of the jail, they also share in the running of the jail. But Stevens County has a fairly new jail, so they're out. They're not gonna ride it. Rayburn County just got a SPLOST and they've already broke ground to expand their jail. Hall County has, you know, multi-million-dollar jail facility, so they're out. White County's jail they've been in 2 jails. They built their jail and they moved in at 96. We moved in average in 97. Since then they built another new jail. And then they didn't build the other one, they could expand it easily. So theirs is expanding. So no, there's no surrounding counties that would be in on that process. Nobody would want to pick up the gauntlet. Yes, ma'am. Beds to a room. So each one of these pod areas holds 32 32 people. And each room has two people in it. Two people to a room. Bunk bed.
Where did the attorneys meet?
Where they meet now? They meet on the backside of visitation. They meet in the laundry room. They meet in the hallway outside the cells. They just wherever we can carve them spot to meet, they meet. And this one we have, right here. This right here is attorney-client meeting rooms. It's pastor meeting rooms. Somebody wants to meet one of them because we have pastors come in, and I meet with so-and-so. So, attorney-client and pastor meeting rooms right there. They are videoed, but not audioed. No audio, they'd be video only. Because in that attorney room, they're sitting on one side of the desk. There's no glass, so they can, if they need to pass papers and stuff back and forth, they can do that. This one's got a courtroom in it, so we can have hearings inside the court, inside the building. So if we have a murder, and we do not want to take it over to the courthouse, and we can arrange a judge to come in, they'll have their own entrance, and bring the inmate down to the security facility, and then do a hearing, and not have to leave the facility. Because we've had issues in the past with taking folks to jail and having visitors show up. So inside this building, the only people that have offices, the only people want to come see. Yeah.
How many square foot do you space? How many square foot?
91,000.
91,000?
Yeah. When you add those up right there, it's a little over 91,000. What it come out to be. So we're not putting the whole sheriff's office in the building. So we're still going to use the old building because we have put patrol in it, we have investigators that have to go in it, we have training that needs to go in it, evidence and evidence, custodians are going to stay in it. We're staying credit, she also does that. Justin Williams, our sex offender, his office will still be in there. Patrol commander's office will be in that building. We have three storage containers out back that are slammed full of records that we was going to use the old jail part to store records in, take the doors off, you know, use the exhaust fans, turn heat and air off, and use the exhaust fans to keep the air moving. So we store all those records in there. So in this building, I still have an office, records, so accident incident reports. The chief deputy and then the jail staff will be in this building. Because those are the folks that everybody wants to always come see. So I didn't feel like it was very nice to have folks run all over the country to, you know, well, you gotta go to the building next door and ring the doorbell. And somebody will come get you. I don't do all that. And so we talked about this 500 to 500 number, the kitchen, the laundry. The inmate property storage area is all big enough to be able to feed 500. Yes, we could cut it down. We could make this a 314-bed jail. We could cut that out, make that smaller, save some money. But I think somewhere down the line, we got to think about the future. My kids. Your kids, grandkids, I know most of you got a half a dozen brand new babies. So, we've got to think about our kids down the road. Yes. Let me show you where the. There's the future expansion on that side. Get you these things down there. There's room over here to add on. I've kind of bounced around all over the place. Any other questions? Or did I make it work? Yes, sir.
I don't think most people question needing a new jail. I don't think most people care who's in it. I think what people are wondering is why are we going to pay, you know, another $25 million in interest, and what are the other options in financing it, and how much will it cost to run it year by year versus what it costs now?
I can't talk to you about Jackson County to run their jail and what it takes us to run our jail. But I do know that jails are energy hogs. That's one of the standards we're missing. We do not circulate the air inside the facility. That's one standard we're missing. So we have to circulate the air like 4 or 5 times more than a commercial structure. So yes, there's going to be, what's it going to take to run it? I don't know. We don't know what's going to take. You talking about the money? But what we do hope is, with the new facility, the toilets won't be a 3 gallon flush toilets. They'll be 1 gallon. We'll be able to control each one. So if somebody's sitting there like they do now, going, we turn water off. We turn toilet off with a flip of the switch. We control all the lights individually. As it is now, either all the lights are on or all the lights are off. So. And we've switched up all of our lights to LEDs in the building as it is now. So we're hoping, to have a more energy efficient building and be able to control a lot of this stuff that will help with the cost of the building. I do know that we're going to have to move the air over much more because we do not. I do know that.
How did they come up with a price of 30, whatever? I mean, has there been an architectural drawing of this thing? I mean, do they know everything that's going to be in it? Where did you come up with that price?
To answer your question, we work with obviously consulting, the top consultant in the state. We work with the sheriff and commander and Mike Smith, who does a lot of work with Steel Cell, and they calculated that it's going to cost $31.6 million. And $27 million is hard cost, $2,300,000. Soft cost, $2 million contingency. And that number was a little bit bigger last year, I was saying earlier. And they've gone through and value engineered that down to get to that number. We've got a lot of confidence that it can be built for that cost, and that we can't exceed that cost. It'll be enough to exceed.
And some of the things like we're building a correctional type facility, we're only two companies that make locks for correctional. You can't go to Walmart for Lowe's and buy a lock for a jail. So there's only two companies. The control system, there's only one or two companies that build the control systems for jails. So it's like when you get you call a builder and say, hey, I want to build a house. Here's a square footage and this is what I want it. Give me a price. So we went to a builder of jails, a designer of jails, and that's how we got that number. Now, is that number high? Yeah, it probably could be high. So you're going on current jail.
It might not be high enough.
And it might not be high enough. You go on current jail trends and what it's cost to build jails, and then they figure what the sales cost. What your one huge part of this is all the electronics. Because everything is all touch screen now. Everything's all touch screen now.
Let me answer the other question you had is, SPLOST. The reason is, this is recently decided quite a long time.
Other funds.
There's about, SPLOST generates the equivalent of about 5 mills, and it's all taken. There's about a mill's worth of cost related to the hospital bond. There's an ambulance replacement every year. They have to replace an ambulance every single year because they wear out.
rather than putting the entire burden on the current taxpayers? And what do we do with all those projects that are not, that are currently funded by SPLOST that have to be done?
Let me ask you another question.
Go ahead, ma'am.
Was the courthouse and the administration building on the ballot?
The courthouse is on the ballot, yes, the administration building was not.
Why?
It was done, it didn't need to be done on the ballot. It was done through a lease purchase.
Who decided to put this on the ballot?
The county commission back in March, they looked at it and discussed this.
Why?
Greg, I appreciate asking. Legally, the commission could have done it without a public vote. I don't want to speak for all the commissions. I didn't have a problem. I thought that was an end around. I think the public should decide on this kind of big ticket item how they want to spend their money.
I think they should have decided on the courthouse and the administration building, because there's 50 buildings sitting that could have been remodeled for that administration.
That was before I got office. Well, what,
no,
you talk to
me? I'm tired of hearing that.
I didn't make that decision. I'm just saying, well, what with you, you're talking about the current courthouse we have now?
Yes.
Okay, and I'm
why not use the upper level for the administration?
For the administration?
It wouldn't fit.
Well, it wouldn't fit. It wouldn't fit. Nowhere near it.
Why didn't you build it?
Because we need it for gym. The judges, the Superior Court judges said we need X amount of space for future growth. There is plans very soon to open up new courthouses, a new court room, and support staff for the courtroom on that third floor. So we're going to use that space. We're going to see part of it. You can't just build. When you look at public facilities, this is the hard part. If you build what you need now and you don't plan for growth, you're gonna get all kinds of problems very quickly. So when they built the courthouse, which it might not be a good answer, but I wasn't involved in that, but my understanding of the decision-making process that the commissioners took at that time was the judges said we need room for future growth. That's what the judges told us. So the commissioners listened to the Superior Court judges and they made it bigger so we could grow into it. That seems logical to me.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I know
the
Rosie Bridges is passed
today.
So is that why all the
RC
property taxes
going
to have to
be
washed?
I just want to make sure.
On the referendum.
This one,
yes.
On November. Is that why
y'all didn't go that route?
Well, hindsight's 2020. And T-SPLOST failed, voters didn't win it, so it was time to move on. But I want to answer your question. If T-SPLOST had passed, there would have been, we would have been able to move money, the money that Phil talked about, that we're using in SPLOST roads and bridges, we would have moved that money out of there because we wouldn't need it because T-SPLOST would fund it. That would have left money available in SPLOST that would have covered within a couple, $200,000 to $300,000. The debt service. Well, if the money, that money was for roads and bridges in SPLOST. It was earmarked for roads and bridges. If T-SPLOST had passed, it's for roads and bridges. We wouldn't have needed that money in the SPLOST, which would open that money up, which we then could have used to cover the majority of the debt service on into the jail. We still would have needed a bond, right, to get the money up front so we could build the thing. But the debt service, most of the debt service could have been in there. But it doesn't. I mean, it's all it's history. But I get getting back to your original question, the commission voted and felt in May, March, that the people, this was a big decision about a lot of money, and the people need to make that decision, not elected officials.
But you said so much that the people are tired of
it. Is there a reason why you can't have another SPLOST? Now, I just heard that there were two jails built on the SPLOST. So why can't you have another?
The next SPLOST will come up for a vote this time next year. But like I said, there's so many other things that have to go
list up. What are they? Let's hear those things that you say have to be voted on. Because you can take those and move those up. Well, we're not buying a hospital anymore. We're not buying a hospital anymore. You can't do it.
Yes, we are.
No, you've sold it. We are no longer lease purchase of the hospital. You're paying for it. Those are general obligation bonds.
No, we're not. It's a revenue bond. It's a hospital revenue bond.
You cannot pay for SPLOST out of that.
It hasn't been sold, Carl. It won't be sold for another 5 years.
You sold that last SPLOST to us, and I helped with Chad Henderson, and we worked on that, and that was to actually do a lease purchase of that hospital.
And it hasn't been purchased.
You've signed a definitive agreement to sell that. So you're no longer purchasing that.
Not now, Carl. 5 years from now.
Listen, you can smile all you want to and laugh about it, but you're not going to buy that hospital.
Screw.
So we're going to have to pay that. So that can't be on SPLOST.
Yes, it can.
No, it can't.
That's one of the roads and bridges to the other.
Then the roads and bridges. The roads and bridges.
These cars
need to be owned. I've heard this for time and time again. Oh, we don't have our loss because we gave it away. Well, those roads and bridges needs to go on, and we move those off and put them on the general bond. This needs to be on SPLOST. This is what SPLOST is for. Y'all taking stuff that shouldn't be on there and put it on there.
Doesn't fit.
Yes, it does too. SPLOST is $30-something million. We had $35 million last time. We're going to have $38 million this time.
Is what SPLOST represents. Okay, let me just wrap this up.
Let me ask you a question. So, no, you don't want to talk about this for you?
The language of the bond referendum.
You don't want to talk about this for
you? We'll be happy to talk with you,
Carl.
Offline.
We'll stay here online. I'll talk with you.
Talk to you all night long.
Just let it be simple. Let them finish the presentation. Then we can address everybody's questions.
Joey did a great job on that. There's no doubt that we don't need the jail. So there's no doubt about that. The financing of this jail versus the SPLOST is what everybody, or the people that I know, have a problem with.
Carl, you asked us specifically to put it on a bond referendum.
No,
you asked yes, sir.
Yeah, I did, because y'all were going to create a authority, and I said, don't do the authority.
No, we were considering all options.
No, but you did not put this.
We never committed to creating
a bond referendum.
That
was a lie, Natalie. That is a lie.
No, that's something that you created in your own mind.
I was against the authority. At that time, we'll go back in and we'll pull the stuff, and you'll see it, Natalie. Don't try to spin it.
There's no spin here. That's wrong. You spin in the community all the time.
You
asked us specifically to do
it. I specifically asked you not to do the authority.
And let me just finish this up, and we can continue on with the questions, okay? On the referendum, the question will be, shall general obligation bonds in the aggregate principal amount of up to $31.7 million be issued by Habersham County, Georgia, in order to finance the jail? What that represents financially in last year's millage rate is 1.8 mils. If I just ticked up a little bit this year's millage rate, it would be 1.6 mils, and over time, that'll be 1.36. Thank you, Stacy. We'll continue to gradually ease down. What that represents to the average property owner, homeowner in the county, is $71 a year. If you take that monthly, that's $5.92 per month.
Yeah, now, most of the time when y'all figure something like that, you're saying the average homeowner, his house is worth $150,000. Why did you go down to 135? Make it look better?
That's the average home right now. The average home is $135,000. Okay. Are there any other questions for the sheriff or myself or Commissioner?
Yes, sir.
I have
some questions
that
way. Some of them deal with past county commissioners. Long deal.
federal, 5% state, 5% local for most of that project.
Sutton, while you're up there, if you turn to page 2 of that thing, you have to explain it.
Can you better explain
it? He's still talking.
That's when you get to 314.
Well, it
maximum, three classification inmates. So the U.S. Supreme Court says you shall classify inmates. But we don't. And that's how you classify them in these clause systems around here. So this one right here could have the minimum in it, which is, could be our what misdemeanor people we have or whatever coming in. Or the ones that come in during the week that go in and out for whatever charges. Then over here could be some of the half a dozen sex offenders we got could be stuck in this pod. And then in this pod right here could be some of my folks who are on suicide watch, protected custody and stuff. And then in this cell right here, we're gonna put our max people. So say I have 10 people who's in maximum classification. So I put 10 people in that bed, that pod for 32 beds. What happens in about the 22 beds in that pod? They're empty. They're useless. You take them off the count because you cannot use them. People, we even talk about females. The jail's 30%. The 30% of our jail population now is females and growing. They're there for 2 months ago, we had more there for child support than we did men. Women. So I have two women that need to be classified in the maximum type classification. So I take them, I put them in this cell right here. The two that I'm supposed to classify as maximum. That was another 30 beds. They're empty. I can't use them. You have to take them off the count. So just because we want to build a 314 bed jail doesn't mean that we're going to have 314 beds available. Because if we properly classify, that's the problem looking at these other jails, is they can't house in the inmates because they're doing classification, so they can't take our inmates in. We properly classify inmates, there'll be somebody in every one of these blocks. And we'll turn off the lights in the cells we don't use. But we will put bodies in every one of these blocks because we are supposed to properly classify inmates. That's way up on the list. I didn't talk about, we are not doing that. We have to do it, but the U.S. Supreme Court says you shall, and we don't. We can't, the jail's not designed to do that.
How long ago did they tell you you had to do that?
It's been years. Yeah, this has been a long time. Really, when this jail was built, we moved into it not doing what we're supposed to do. The other big thing is we're all adults here, so I'm going to talk about it. So you can't put this out on the internet. This part. So in the old jail, another major point that we're doing is we are violating people's rights of privacy. So I have those folks that come in. They do come in, and the only thing they're charged with is disorderly conduct. That's the only charge. They don't have a criminal history. They've never been in trouble before. They go in that big block in Homes 86 because mama says, I ain't coming to get you. Wife says, I told you not to be stupid. They stay in jail. Well, I have female detention officers. So she's working for me. She's watching the block. Come here, stand up here with me. This is my female detention officer, and she's watching the block from that control room. So that male's got to go over there. Sorry, I'm pointing there. That male's got to go over there, and he's got to get disrobed and get naked in the block. In front of everybody, including the female detention officer, and get in the shower, and then get back out of the shower and dry off. I just violated his right of privacy, according to the Constitution and the Supreme Court. That's the way up around the top of the rest of the country.
Not against
the new jail. I'm just talking about, Mr. McDonald brought up some points about why we're doing 300 beds. These are some, I missed that point. We talked about classification. I missed it.
Well, we've gotten away with it for 20 years.
Exactly, but it only takes one time. You go and defend, or can I put you on retainer? No charge to defend me when the county gets in a lawsuit? Because I'm not having one. Oh no, I don't want the counties. I'm getting my own money. I love them, but I'm getting my own attorney. So we did have a lawsuit, okay? We had one lawsuit. We filed the Title 83 U.S. lawsuit. Yeah, 1983 U.S. lawsuit. file in federal court. If he filed that baby in federal court, we would have been before the courts then.
He could have still filed in federal court if he wanted to.
Oh, absolutely he could have. But he wanted out of jail is all he wanted. He claimed he couldn't get around, he's using his elbows, pulling stuff around, but he walked into the jail. So we've already had one lawsuit. All it takes is one, and you know. Yes, Bob?
When the new jail gets built, will these empty cells be for hire from out from other counties?
Absolutely. Females is the biggest thing.
Can we actually build this jail and make money with it?
We could. Not hanging my hat on that.
Okay, so if we're going to do it, that's the way the county can make money. You can get some of this money back instead of 314, 350, 400 to start off with. And say instead of 60, 65, can you say how about 80 to 100? And I believe it'd still come in, wouldn't it?
I don't know if you go that high, you can get it.
But, business is business.
Business is business. Now, it's all about females. If we build the jail, we move in tomorrow. Females is the biggest drug population in the state. And no other jail is built big enough to hold females. White County's got some money. But nobody else does. Jackson County doesn't. Hall County doesn't. Not even Gwinnett. And on down into Fulton, they'll have enough room to hold more females. So there is room to house other prisoners. There's the possibility of housing prisoners for the U.S. Marshal Service. And 20 years ago, they were paying $65 a day. So those possibilities are out there, but I don't want to talk about, hey, we're going to build this jail, we're going to make all this money. No, I don't want to talk about it. But there's a possibility, yes. Also, we build this jail, we're going to move into it with the same amount of personnel we got. I didn't talk about that. We run 5 per shift, 7 here and 8, another couple extra. Sightlines, with the called indirect supervision, not going to blocks. So we're going to run up the same amount of people we've got now. Yes, we get up to 225, 250. Yes, we're going to have to add one or two more people. But as it stands, we've got to add more people. That was part of our requirements. We didn't want to have to add more people to run this jail. So that has to answer any questions.
In 22 years from 1997, when this present jail was built, until now, there's only been 130 for which it was built to 159 present to end of 2018. So the point is, that's only a 29 number increase in 27 years. And what we're looking at, the world may end tomorrow, but 100 more years, I don't know. But we need to look at what we need right now more than what we need necessarily in 30 years.
That's what got us in the whole game right now.
Well, it is.
I love you. We'll disagree on that one for now because of things.
He's looking at average day of time.
Yeah.
The sheriff will tell you, he and I are very close friends. I've gone to sit down and talk with him for an hour and a half, 2 hours about this thing. But the question is, do we need it? Do you know it's not a matter of 31,700,000, by the way, it's going up 100,000. It's 31,600,000.
That's a roundup. 31,600,000.
100,000, 30,000, so on. What you don't realize is in 30 years, you're going to be paying back. And I've got the exact figure here. In 30 years, you're going to be paying back $53,393,550. With the hospital that we're going to be lining up paying for the next 25 or close to 30 years, is another $60 million you're going to be paying. That doesn't include the school taxes that you're now paying. $71 increase on a $135,000 house is about $850 a year more tax. That person is going to pay for that $135,000 house.
No, it's $71.
$71
a year.
Add to that the school tax. Add that to the school tax. And
that's already
other
there.
Taxes.
Oh, that's right there.
That's not an additional. That's not an add-on.
Anybody else got questions?
Yeah, I would like to say something to that, just because I do feel kind of like I'm representing the younger generation, which I'm frustrated that more of us are not here. But if this is an issue that's on the table right now, And I would rather do what we need to do to be able to rectify this issue and invest what we need to invest so that I'm not seeing this on the ballot again in 10 years because we didn't plan for the necessary steps and we're having to do all this over again. Because then on top of the 53 that we're paying for the next however long you said, now we have to build a whole new building. And it just, I would prefer to make that investment and be able to accommodate whatever the future may hold. Now, I bring that around to I'm all about trying to get the numbers down, trying to get the people out of the jail and focus on kind of that portion of the problem. So I'm hoping that, you know, in 20 years there's only 100 people in jail. But we don't know, and I would rather be safe than sorry.
No, there's another officer involved shooting the gun about 15 minutes ago.
This is a preamble question that I have on this other call. How long is the oldest prisoner in jail now? How long has he been in this?
Well, 2 minutes?
Yeah.
A little under 600 days.
600 days?
That's more.
That's close to 2 years. Folks, as a defense lawyer, I have always been in favor of speedy trials. It's the best thing for the community. It's the best thing for our prison system. Interestingly, it's the best thing for the inmate. All we need to do is we need to convict those who are in jail. We need to go to state prisons the next day, bringing our population down every day that the next one goes.
And those who I challenge you and everybody in this room. Come set through court. See what we'll
deal with. I'm gonna finish up.
And you have a nod on your head like I did.
I will finish up with maybe what you have concluded about talking. Those who are innocent need to go home. They don't need to sit in jail for a long time. I've been in the legal business 50 plus years. I've been in out every jail in this county for two courthouses, two and a half, really three courthouses. Those people who are awaiting trial, and I didn't have much here. I don't know if you have an actual figure.
I actually have percentages for you.
What's for
January, it was, or for 2016, at 66% of people were awaiting trial. 2017, 73%, and 2018, at 76%. So for all of them, for all 3 years, it's 72.11% are awaiting trial.
Where's my number?
I just got the percentages of this average.
I think that's the same list.
Yes, sir.
Folks, the point I want to make is this, and I've seen it, and I know it, I've had it work, watched it. Maybe 50 years. This is going to step on some toes. You know why those people are waiting in jail as long as they are not going to trial? Yes. They can work. Haven't heard from their lawyer, number one. I'd hate to tell you the percentage of people in our county, around the state, around the country, who has a free public defender. It's put private practice lawyers out of business and a criminal defense fee. It has. Not that I'm complaining. Now, this is what's so important. We have two Superior Court judges in three counties. We have one district attorney in three counties. They are understaffed. Public defender's office is underpaid. You know who pays for assistant DAs and who pays for assistant public defenders? The county does. They beg, the public defender's office begs three counties for more public defense lawyers. And the county's commissioners say, if we hire more, we're going to have to go up on taxes.
Absolutely. The state pays for most of the public defenders and most of the assistant attorneys and the district attorney, of course. And the county does supplement.
Both the DA and the public defenders have asked for more help. We need more judges. told the sheriff, and I believe this firmly as a defense lawyer, that if they would set court and hold court week after week after week after week for a few months, you would see that 159 average inmates there drop to, you would not believe how low, because they would either plead guilty or they would go to trial, and it would empty our jails, and we don't have to spend $50+ million in the next 30 years.
Just for the record, I sat down with Superior Court Judge Shane Caudill at length on multiple occasions to talk specifically about that. I asked him verbatim, if we add more judges, which the state makes that decision, it's not the county. If we add more Superior Court judges, can we get these people out of the jail faster so we don't have to go to jail? He said, it would make a difference.
Would?
He said it would not make a difference, is what he told me. Now, I'm just telling you what he told me. Secondly, we've added a public defender district, full-time public defender district, right?
Right.
Okay. So, I just wanted to let you know what the Superior Court judge told me.
50 years says different.
I'm not saying he's right or wrong.
To Chairman Hall's point, this year is different about our support of the public defender's office. We added a full-time public defender. And yes, he has come and he has asked for money. I guess I'll say, as the longest sitting county commissioner on the commission today, there have been lots of mistakes prior to the iteration of the commission that's in place right now. But for the last 7 years, we comb through the budget line by line every year. And if you don't think that we put an emphasis on doing the very best we can with your tax dollars, I challenge you to come to those budget hearings. Come to each and every one of them. I promise you, we pay taxes here too.
I got a question for you, ma'am. The new administrative building costs $13 million, okay? Voters didn't get to vote on it. But meanwhile, the old Ingalls building in Clarksville is sitting there empty with lots of parking. And don't tell me it can't be remodeled and made nice enough for Habersham County. Army Special Operations Command's got a building there, and it's big, and they got dividers in between it, and this, that, and the other. You could have done the same thing with the Ingalls building instead of spending $13 million on that. It wouldn't have cost near that. We could have put it to the new jail.
It did not. It was $6 million combined with everything.
Ingalls
is a $6 million building, too.
Six. Ingalls was $700,000.
Wouldn't be any
money. That's just what they want for it.
We're trying to do things that are going to last for a long period of time and do it right.
And look, I want you to be passionate. I do. I'm passionate about my county. That's why I ran for the commission in the first place. Lifelong resident of Habersham County, with the exception of.
Well, I want to be passionate about it too, but we're not keeping up with the Gwinnett and the Joneses.
We're
this
not
is
trying
a
to, but I want to ask you, let me make my comments, and then you can make yours, okay? Please be passionate, and I'm willing to sit here. Chairman Hall's willing to sit here on my own. I can't speak for Commissioner Tinch or Miller, but I'm sure they're willing to sit here with you all night long and talk this through. But the major point is this. This is your decision to make. We're here to give you the information. We're here to present you with the numbers that have been borne out through research. We're not saying this is what we're doing. We're saying, here are the numbers, and we're trying to have town halls, we put up a website, we're accessible to you to answer your questions, but at the end of the day, this is going on a ballot referendum, and it's your decision to make, and if you want it to wait, you can make that decision. We are not forcing this down your throat. We're here to give you the information, and it is your choice to make, along with your friends and your neighbors. And whatever your passion is, however you feel, yes, let's do it now, or no, let's do it later, I encourage you to share your opinion and the information that you've received with your neighbors.
And I'll be honest with you, ma'am, I agree that we need a new jail. I'm not arguing that. I am. I just, historically speaking, since there's just been a lot of what I consider bad, poor decisions.
I agree. That's what I mean in the first place. We're trying to not make those same kinds of decisions. As Mr. Sutton just said, as Chairman Hall has said, we want things that are good investments that will last and that will provide some kind of better return to this county. Because let me tell you, when I took office in 2013,
it never, commissioners, you know, when you get arrested, you have to be bonded out. Has it ever been thought out that the election officials within this county system should have to post a bond? When they make that wrong decision, they should be held accountable. Like the purchase of the Hills Crossing property, we lost $500,000. Has it ever occurred that maybe if they were bonded, $250,000 cash or property, that would be a lot less, you know, to say, okay, let's do that, you know, well, that'll work. We lost $500,000, or whatever we lost. But until elected officials are held accountable for their actions, this is going to keep happening. I'm not saying here, I'm saying we're doing a lot better than we were years ago, by all means. But it is my feeling that if they were held accountable, bonded, you know, they'd say, well, I could lose my house. And they'd be a lot out to slow down and think.
I have a lot of thoughts about what you have given what we cleaned up over the last 7 years. But
I mean, if you were held accountable,
because
when you drive fast, you do drugs, you get in a fight or something, you go to jail, you got to have a bond to get out. What about these elected officials when they make mistakes? Has it ever occurred to anybody, these people, if you want to do it, if you want to get in there and get at it, have at it, post a bond. When you mess up, you pay.
I tell you this, if that were in place, I still would have run. So hopefully,
I'd post the bond
everybody
in a minute.
Vote on it next year.
So what is, okay, so if this doesn't pass then, what happens?
He's going to do it.
You put it on next SPLOST, you won't do it.
Hold out for the SPLOST in 20.
Yeah. It was changing the list.
This will cost
you on the what? Then you won't have to pay the.
Then you don't pay interest on 24 years.
Drops into federal court. you'll think $50 million is expensive when they say you build this jail, you build this way, it'll cost this much, we don't care. So that's what I worry about. Franklin County was the last one I know of close to us who was under a federal mandate. And the only reason that they didn't have to build the federal system's jail was they were as close as we are to it. So it could be our saving grace. So it might not happen. We might go 10 years and never, you know, and it never happened.
We supply a stale to pay for it, and just pay for it on the long time residents that are here now to pay for it. That's been one of my big roads over the years.
It's only fair tax. And the legislature can do anything. Chris kind of slipped out on us, but I talked to him. I've talked to Terry and Chris about it. You know, what would it take to get a public safety SPLOST to pay for the jail? You know, our radio system next year will be obsolete, not making stuff no more. We got to have a new public safety radio system.
How much?
No. Depends. Could be anywhere from 5 million to 25 million. Just more stuff, technology, you know. So, and talk about ambulances, patrol cars. You know, I get 4 cars a year, get 2 off the budget, 2 off the SPLOST, but I need about 6 because we spent nearly half again to double last year in parts per maintenance and getting cars on the road. So, there's a whole bunch of stuff. That SPLOST is a fair tax, it gets everybody. And those folks stop through and get it, it gets the penny out of their pocket, too. Yeah, but you got to think an ambulance is $200,000.
And right now they're wearing them out.
Absolutely.
They make 10 to 12 trips a day from this hospital to the Northeast Georgia Hospital. I mean, why are they moving everybody down there?
Yeah, you've got to talk about it for years.
No, they've been.
Any other questions about the jail?
How much they do it now?
Roll this thing up. I lost that steaks. Cook. I like no meat. Volunteers. Ain't nobody knocking the door down to come up and help volunteer.
Well, the other piece of that too
people, I don't want the child molesters and the murderers and those folks. I don't want them out on the streets working. So we only have a limited number of people we can even let out that I'll even, that I will let out. Now, I got a lot of bodies that can go out and work, but I don't trust them out there. And what, in this facility was talking about, we're gonna have a classroom so we can do GED classes. I can't even do GED classes, but I need a volunteer who will come do it. I need somebody who will step up to teach the classes. I don't have that now. Again, there's nobody knocking the door down who wants to do it. But we can also have church classes, and we can have, we can teach people how to balance a checkbook because they don't have life skills. You know, I've got, I do have folks that'll do that. So we can try and help our part in rehabilitating people to not come back in it. But here's the big thing. I don't care what you pour at people. I don't care if the state offers a free rehab, and I say free, there ain't nothing free in mine. It'll come off tax dollars from someplace. But if they have a rehab that anybody can go to, until that person decides that they want to stop doing drugs, or they want to stop stealing, I don't care what you do, they're going to continue to do it. And I have a whole bunch of people in that building right now. That's what they are. They don't care about anybody. They will sell their kids' toys so they can get dope. They will spend whatever money they can spend and take away from their children. I had a lady, she's had 13 kids. Her ninth one, she had a facility. We took her to jail, she had the baby, defects took it, she came right back to jail. She sits on 13. All she wants is dope. She don't want nothing else. She don't care about nothing else. And that's the people we have in jail. That's the folks that's in there. Now, can it be ministered to? Absolutely they can be. They're a captive audience. So we have church groups that come in and they minister to them. But a lot of these folks, because I, you know, I'm a Christian, so I, you know, I'm supposed to see the good in people. Well, sometimes I don't see the good in people. I struggle with that. Because there's people that need to be in jail. I'm sorry. I disagree with you. There's folks that's got to be in there. And I see it coming. I see the stuff on the street. I see the stuff coming. Officer involved shooting gangs. Hall County's coming this way, folks. It's coming this way. And they're bringing all that garbage with them. The inner and the autos. The kids. They were kids that entered those cars over there and stole all that stuff. Stole those two people. They were kids. All right, now legislators, their infinite wisdom is wanting to take anybody who's 17 and under and make them all juveniles. If you're 17, you'll be a juvenile. You don't go to big kid jail. But did I mention that Deputy Dixon, that kid killing was 17 years old? We deal with them every single day, kids, because they're not raised in a home. They don't know no better. So society as a whole, the wheels will fall off the bus because nobody cares. And we're seeing the after effects of that. And it's growing. I'm telling you, it's growing. I see it coming. It's growing. Our judges do a good job of keeping people out of jail. We try to keep stuff going. Our governor just said he wants a 4% cut in the budget to 6 next year. Well, that's all fine, well, and dandy. You know what that happens to all that? Public defenders get laid off. They're cutting out the Capitol Defense team. What do you think that's going to do to our justice system now? So the first thing the GBI did, they cut the classes for new agents. State Patrol cut their classes for new troopers. I got a passion for several years.
And on about with the drugs, you know, according to research, you know, it takes a minimum of 2 to 2.5 years to go brain just be chemically even part. That's no emotional, it's no moral, that's just a chemical balance back in your brain from the last use.
It probably, and I'd say it'd take longer than that if somebody didn't get it back at all, because
that,
now,
that's on the positive side. That's the best case scenario. If you slip one time through that 2 to 2.5 years, you start back. It may be a higher level, but you start back.
So,
from square one,
basically. Vapes, we all know about vapes. I hope none of y'all vape in here. That's the worst thing you'll do. Who makes that stuff? We don't know who makes it. So now we have THC, okay? You can tell I'm not a big THC fan. So we have THC vape cartridges. Kids are OD'ing on them. Now they found them in South Carolina with arsenic in them. So do you know that dope dealers take fentanyl and they put it into drugs and they give it to people? Now why would they do that? For free of charge. Why would they do that? To raise their business. It's got a higher edge. It's got a higher edge to it. Their business spikes when somebody overdoses and dies. You know, we are all carrying Narcan, which is the off-brand of it's naloxone is the name of that one. We carry it in the jail, all of our officers carry it, and we're going to, we use that stuff nearly every week now on the road, because the people on the street, they know we carry it. They know the ambulance is carrying it. So now they're pushing in, they're pushing the edge even harder. Why? Because the police is going to come save them, because we do. Ambulance is going to come save them, because we do. Is it a bad thing? No. We have saved folks. We have saved lives. We've had to use it in the jail. We're all adults. People smoking stuff in the jail. We had a lady brought in a cell phone and a charger. Use your imagination. Men bring stuff in all the time. All the time. They smuggle it in. So we get stuff in the jail. And we've had to use the naloxone in the jail for heroin overdose.
People say that the bad stuff is what's on the street. But what's in the
bath salts and stuff, there's still people going crazy. People will smoke anything. I don't care. They take Epsom salts and try and smoke it. Crush them up. Shoot them up. I see the guy take it. He took brute and person, squeezed it through a sock, flashed it off the water, and drank it. Floor wax. Drink floor wax.
I think we all know that drugs get wasted, huh?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I just feel like the county commissioners and you need to keep on sacrificing, doing the best you can, because I don't think we need to spend $32 million more in this county at this time. I'm sorry.
But here's what, and it ain't a sacrifice.
I'm sorry that it affects you. But it's not
affects you. It affects you. That's what it affects. It affects you. And here's the problem. I'm not going to sacrifice. We're going to keep doing what we're doing. It ain't a sacrifice. We're going to keep doing what we're doing. We're not going to stop, you know, trying to house out inmates and keeping everybody safe and running back and forth. We're going to keep doing what we're doing. We're going to stop. When you call 911, we're going to be there. If somebody needs to be locked up, we're going to keep on. Here's what I'm worried about. When that one person don't want to go back to prison, they're going to Lumpkin County, they set up an ambush and they wreck that van. Think $31 million is expensive?
Sure.
Or we get that one lawsuit and they make us do it. That's what I worry about. Well, it might not ever happen. It might not ever, ever, never happen. But it could. That's what I worry about. But if it doesn't pass, then I'll be, we're going to keep on doing what we're doing. We're not going to stop.
Sure. Nobody's upset with you.
Oh, no, I know.
There's a single person here upset with you.
She talks about passion. Can you tell what I got a passion for? It's the only reason I'm here. Because I love doing what I do. You know, I've been to your house many times. You call me, I come down there, right? I'll come down to your house if you call me, anytime. We sit and talk about whatever. I got a passion. I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do.
Yes. This is the thing. This is the bottom. This county has always lived on the back of the property owner. And as we have grown, we have still relied on the property owner. We've reached a tipping point. Property owner can't give no more. Okay, we have no industry in this county, and I don't know that we're even searching to get any. And if we don't, we can't keep going. The people here can't. Now, maybe we can all go somewhere else and you can bring in some rich ones who can keep paying. But I won't be here. My people won't be here. We'll be gone. All right? So the leaders of this county, it is incumbent that they do something about bringing in money into this county because the property owner can't do it. We can't do it anymore.
Okay, we got any more jail questions? No, I'm going to wrap it up. I can still have that couple steak. I appreciate y'all coming. Sometimes we make more questions than we come up with answers. So I appreciate all y'all being here.